Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Dan, I'm good.
The Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for life and for this beautiful day. Give this board the strength, integrity, and the know-how to serve the public and do what is best for the county of Alamance. Amen.
Amen.
Please join in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to everybody. We have a nice large crowd today. I think, do we have folks sitting in the back also? Yes, okay. First item on our agenda is for public speakers. And we have one this morning, Antonio.
Good morning. Well, you know, it seems like in America today, if you got a name that looks other than American, Antonio Agridius, that's my, Tony is my first name, but people use these different Antonio, Anthony, blah, blah, blah. And Agridius, that's after my daddy. And they was poor down in Rockingham Hamlet, and he had a lot of brothers and sisters. And when he was born, the doctor told his mama, "If you'll let me name that boy," he said, "I'll pay. You don't have to pay for my part of the bill." And his boy's name was Agridius. Somehow or another, they said he got killed coming back from the war. But, you know, in America, it seems like if you got plenty of money, you can go down to one of your courthouses and get you some justice. It's amazing to me. Hundreds of thousands of dollars on one side, millions of dollars on the other, and both of them, from what I understand, have unlimited resources. But, if you're like me, you know, in the DOJ depositions, it was called white niggers. I guess I'm one of them. I hate it. I hate it, I hate it, I hate it. You can take the truth seeking justice, and you can beg, you can cry, you can do anything you want to, but that justice don't come. But if your name happens to be something else, or if your color happens to be something else, or your sexual orientation happens to be something else, you've got rights. You've got rights. Boy, I wish I had rights. Man, oh man. I remember back when I used to go to Broadview Middle School, and I rode the school bus 103, and I was the minority on that school bus. And there was this guy on that bus that had him a real dark tan. He used to like to hit on me with his fist. Finally, my mom and them went over there to Broadview Middle School and said something about it. And this boy went to Cummins High School. We middle school and high school rode the bus together. And they said, "Well, we're going to assign him a seat right behind the bus driver." Well, every morning, that guy with that real dark tan, he sat right behind the bus driver, and he was friends with the bus driver. And when I got in that seat, he would elbow me. But see, I don't know. It's amazing to me. Where is our Constitution at? You know, y'all are the defenders of it. Y'all said, "I do solemnly swear." It's amazing. But hey, This group over here, they said that they didn't bring their Hollywood star this morning, so y'all just have to deal with whatever they got. I was saying. Dan here, he reached over through the crowd to get him some votes, but he forgot mine. Votes have been lost by one. Love y'all.
Thank you, Tony. Please turn all cell phones off. I don't want to get caught. I left mine in the car, so it won't go off like it usually does. But thank you all of you for coming, Woodland.
I just don't know.
Next thing on the agenda this morning is approval of the agenda, including the consent agenda. Does anyone have any item on the agenda to pull?
Which state that with the mobile home, the individual named in the contract, Mr. Hank has indicated he'll correct that.
All right. Other than that, right. You're satisfied, John?
And I'm satisfied with that as well.
All right. Is there a motion to accept the agenda?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Alamance Community College, Dr. Gatewood.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, I want to thank you for the opportunity to be here before you today to discuss Alamance Community College's facilities needs and the direct correlation that that has on education, training, workforce development, and closing the skills gap for Alamance County citizens. I also want to thank you sincerely for the support that you've given the college over the many years that it has been in service. Allow me to introduce the members of my executive team. Don't get worried, they're not all going to speak, but they're the experts in their field here, so in the event we get certain questions, they will assist me in answering them. Mr. Scott Queen, Executive Vice President. Mr. Kenan Briggs, Vice President of Administrative and Fiscal Services. Ms. Kathy Johnson, Vice President of Instruction. Mr. Wally Shern, Dean of Instructional Technologies. And Ms. Cindy Colley, Controller. Interestingly, when you include me, this team and I have a total of about 140 years of experience, professional experience in education. And this is not the complete team. We have deans and department heads who will also be affiliated with this project who are not here. So I think the point that I'm trying to make here, we are experienced people. In addition, I would be derelict if I did not introduce to you today some of our board of trustees who are here to show support for this facility. And I'd like to begin with the chairman of our board, Mr. Doug Fincannon, Trustee Bill Gomery, Trustee Reed Dusenberry, Trustee Dan Engel, Trustee Carl Steinbicker, and I believe our college attorney, Mr. Frank Longus, is present too. We have people in both rooms, so he could possibly be in there if he's not in here. Equally important, we have with us, and I think this is absolutely critical, and it demonstrates, in my opinion, the fact that the people in this community who are the end users of our products, those people who hire graduates and completers, who know what today's skill sets needs are, and who understand how to build a strong economy. We have a great number of those people with us today, and they've chosen to be here to emphasize the importance of this proposed Advanced Applied Technology Center to make sure that the employers of Alamance community have the people to fill jobs now and into the future. These employers are the backbone of our economy. They understand firsthand how important it is to have state-of-the-art facilities. They know without a doubt that we need such facilities in order to prepare workers for their industries. So I think it's imperative and important that I introduce each of them to you. Now I'll do this very quickly. We don't want to be here late in the day. So I'm just going to run through the names, their titles, and their corporations. Mr. Charlie Harris, one of the founders of Twin Lakes Community, and some of them may be in the other room. Mr. John Leith, owner, Accutate, Acute Incorporated, Mr. Daryl Engel, General Manager, Burlington Honda, Mr. Bill Pendergrass, Senior Facilities Engineer, Cambro, one of our newest industries to come here, Mr. Russ Cox, Vice President, Cox Toyota, Mr. Joe Michaels, Dexco, Mr. Kelly Shirley, General Manager, Dick Shirley Chevrolet, Chuck Ruslanowicz, Director of Operations and Business Development, GKN Drivelines, Ms. Barb Gorman, HR Specialist, GKN Driveline, Mr. Jerry Everett, Operations Manager, Alamance County, GKN Drivelines, Ed Hooks, Territory Sales Manager, Gregory Pool Equipment, Gerald Cunningham, Senior Manager, Compliance and Risk, Honda Power Equipment, Mr. Robert Whitehead, Vice President, Honda Power Equipment, Mr. Tab Joyce, Business Controller, Sandvik Machining Solutions, Mr. Kevin Sasser, Owner and General Manager, Sasser Companies Incorporated, Ms. Allison Newcomer, HR Manager, Sheets, another new entity here in this county. And there may be other business and industry representatives here, but I wanted to mention them by name, by title, and by organization, even though I missed some of the misses. Please forgive me for that, because this is important, folks. We're in this together. Alamance Community College is not standing here alone this morning. We have with us our strong partners, and there are many others out in the community that support what it is we're doing in order to prepare the people of this county for the future. And we also have some students, not a lot of students because they are in the teaching and learning process back on campus, but I would like to mention some students representing automotive mechanics, machining, and welding. Jeff Webster, who is also SGA president, Marcus Glover Saunders, automotive student, Jack McClendon, machining student, and Ashley Board, a welding student. The number of people here today is truly indicative of the support among our students, our trustees, our business leaders, industry leaders for the Advanced Applied Technology Center. They want to ensure that we have the facilities we need to support economic growth of Alamance Community, Alamance County. In addition to recognizing the above supporters, I would like to emphasize that we have faculty and staff at our college, and we have worked diligently for over 6 years preparing for this day, the day that we would actually come before you and make the ask. We have engaged with architects. We have done deep studies to discern what is the best way to go and how to best fill the need that we have regarding the programs that will be housed in the Advanced Applied Technology Center. And we're ready to pull the trigger, if you will, to move forward in this process immediately if you were to approve it. I want you to think about a few things, please. And these are some statistics. Georgetown University Center on Education and Workforce found that by 2010, that's just a few years from now, there would be 55 million new job openings, 24 million from new job creations, and 31 million as a result of retiring baby boomers. Now, some of us in this room can identify with that. And 65% of those new job openings, 55 million, will require education beyond high school. But most of them will require education below a four-year degree level, which means community college. According to industry today, over 90% of all maintenance workers now in the United States, get this, need additional training in order to replace the knowledge gap created by baby boomers. There were some very bright people in our age group who are now leaving the workforce, they're retiring, and so we have to replace that knowledge gap. And we're already behind the curve in doing that. So as indicated by these two reports, there's currently not a significant number. Another way to spin that is we have a shortage of people who are ready and able to support industry. And in order to meet the current and future needs that are being exacerbated by the baby boomer retirements, we need to put in place programs, services, and centers to fill this void. Industry leaders looked at the pool of skilled laborers when they think about where they're going to locate. That's one of the first things they do. how well prepared is the workforce? And guess what? They look at community colleges to provide the training and retraining for their existing employees as well as new employees. If we are to retrain our present industry for our present industry as well as recruit new industries, we must equip Alamance Community College to do the job. We must equip Alamance Community College with state-of-the-art facilities so that we can produce workers who can walk into the industry or the company and begin to make a difference on day one. At this time, if I may, would you please direct your attention to the screen? Mr. Scott Huff, the Vice President, and I would like to give you an overview of the current state of facilities that challenge Alamance Community College to adequately support local business and industry, to adequately support them in preparing our students for present and future jobs. Now, you will note on this slide, you see that Alamance County is hub to education and economic prosperity. That's Alamance Community College. And you could go to almost any county in this state and district all across this nation, and you'll see something very similar, where the community college is really is at the core. It is the hub of economic workforce and educational development. And this, to me, translates to economic viability, economic vitality. This translates to economic development. So this is important, and this is where we are. Now here we have an artist rendering, and this is not what we have. Don't get too excited. This is what we want. This is an artist rendering of the new Advanced Applied Technologies Center. Here we have an aerial view of the Advanced Applied Technologies Center. If you will note here, things are strategically situated, and we will be able to have build synergy by having all of these entities working together. We'll be able to get supplies and equipment in and really be able to produce a better student in using these facilities. So that you will have some ideas of where this building will be located. If you will look at the bottom right, to your bottom right, it's a red silhouette of a building. This is essentially where our building will be located. I think actually it's going to sit back just a little bit further so that we don't consume too many existing parking spaces. And you see the green spaces is a scattering of space where the welding, automotive, heating, ventilating, air conditioning, machining, and carpentry are presently located. So they're sort of discombobulated, if you will, and the way they're situated creates all kind of logistics problems, which Vice President Queen will speak to you about later. Slide six, please. Enrollment headcount. Now, this is a very interesting thing. It is a known fact that when community college enrollment is down, it's generally the economy is doing well. It's doing excellent. So in other words, there is a community college enrollment is inversely related to current economic conditions. When the economy is, maybe I got that wrong. When the economy is up, the enrollment's down generally. When the economy is down, the enrollment blossoms. And this is what we had several years ago. Now, unfortunately, on the one hand, good on another hand, the economy has improved over the last few years, and it continues to improve. And as the economy improved, our overall enrollment has suffered. It's gone down. But here's a good thing. The enrollment started falling in 2011, but as of Friday of last week, we are showing an increase for the first time since 2011. And we believe this increase is due to some work that we have implemented. We've implemented a strategic plan. We've enhanced our enrollment management. We have improved our performance measures. We've strengthened our relationship with K through 12. And forge new partnerships. So our enrollment is on the rebound. This says that although that we've experienced the downturn in the enrollment, in the programs that we're talking about today, they never did. Collectively, from 2008 to 2014, the enrollment in these programs increased by 21%. So what that says is that there is high demand for these programs. There's high demand for skilled workers who can make living wage jobs and be able to support their families. And that, so therefore, we have not suffered. We're doing quite well there. Next slide, please. The new Advanced Technology Center will provide 45,000 square feet of space for teaching and learning. The current facilities collectively equals about 21,000 square feet. The proposed facility, 45,000, for an increase of 112,000. This means that we will be able to educate and train more students, we'll be able to do a better job and prepare them truly for jobs of today and tomorrow. Slide 8. Further details about capacity. With the new facility, our capacity will increase by almost 100 students. Automotive will be able to increase by 25%, 88% with heat and ventilation and air conditioning technology. Machining, 125%. GKN, I bet you like that. Sandvik, I bet you like it as well. And welding, we will be able to increase by 33%. And welding is one of these programs wherein it's hard for us to graduate students because the employers have their arms reached out to them. As soon as they learn how to weld, they're ready to put them to work at a really good wage. Next slide, please. Good wage. The more we can prepare students for highly technical jobs and in demand today, the better the chances are that our students will indeed make living wages. The better the chances are that our students will indeed participate in society in a very great way. They will be able to pay into the tax base. They will be able to support community development. They will be able to give back to the college, because they're going to make between $23,500 and about $45,000 a year. And this is an average range. But you know, I was reading some information last night that showed where machinists were making $57,000 a year and were being given $750 and more as bonuses just to say, yes, I'll come to work in your machining operation. So these data, nevertheless, provided by the Department of Commerce here in North Carolina, but I do question them, but we'll accept them for today. So this is what we have to offer for right now. And I'd like to invite my colleague, Vice President Scott Queen, to come forward and talk to you more about what this new facility will mean to us, what our needs are, and how we'll be able to fill those needs with the new facility. Now, I want to be 100% clear that Mr. Queen, Vice President Queen, will not ask you for anything. His role is simply to provide information. And I can assure you that is all he's going to do. And then I'll come back and we'll wrap this presentation up. Thank you, Mr. Queen. Please come forward.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. Good morning.
Good morning.
What I would like to do in about the next 10 minutes is walk you through the challenges that our faculty and staff face every day when they are delivering top quality instruction in what I would definitely say are substandard facilities. First, I direct your attention to the slide. This is our HVAC, our air conditioning, heating, and refrigeration technology program. What you're looking at here is approximately 20% of their main lab. It is the far end of one of their labs. And notice that you see several large pieces of equipment, one of which several students and instructor are gathered around. The instructor is attempting to do a demonstration. In ideal conditions, these larger units would be stored outside. If you direct your attention to the left of the slide, about halfway up, you notice a piece of plywood onto which various controls have been attached. Again, in an ideal situation, the actual units would be stored outside and the controls would be stored inside, just as they would encounter when they're on the job. So basically here, again, you see very crowded conditions. And this is, I'm guessing, is probably a maybe 15 by 20 space, only part of their lab. So again, very difficult to teach and learn in this space effectively. This is the remainder of their main lab. Notice you cannot see all of them, but it accommodates 12 work tables. A new facility would provide up to 24. A couple of other talking points. Towards the back of the slide, you have a difficult time seeing it, but there, by design, there's actually an air handler in the middle of this facility that takes up a fairly large footprint. Not only that, when it comes on, it makes a lot of noise. So it's very distracting when the instructor is in there trying to teach. Something else to mention about this space is storage. And when I talk about the need for additional storage, I want you to understand that this goes way beyond just needing additional cabinets to store instructional supplies and shelving. There are safety concerns. There are liability concerns, OSHA concerns, and so forth. So our department head in HVAC, I have to say, does a very good job of utilizing literally probably every square inch of space in this facility. If you were to pan around this lab along the floor, there are propane tanks stored and so forth. And he is very organized about it, but there are things stored under the tables. So essentially, again, overcrowded conditions and not at all a modern facility. I had a meeting at Guilford Technical Community College this past spring. This is one picture from their facility located on their East Wendover campus, which is only 12 miles from our county line. And what you see here, what ACC does not have the space to do, first of all, you see there's an enormous space. There are a couple of rows, actually, of complete HVAC systems that students can train on and learn about from different manufacturers. And I may not have the actual terminology correct here, but I'm going to do the best that I can. What I'm seeing is a complete setup from the air intake to the unit itself, to the gas line hookup, to the air return, and to the thermostat. So there are probably two rows of, I would guess, between 20 and 24 of these units set up. Now, it was difficult for me to photograph because classes were in session, and it's a little tricky. You can't just go in and photograph students while class is in session. But if you were to turn around, there's an even much larger space with student workstations and a very spacious area for the instructor to do demonstrations. Another advantage to Guilford Tech's facility that we would offer in a new Advanced Applied Technology Center is the fact that they do have covered outdoor space in which they can work. In conjunction with their carpentry program, they have constructed a temporary, if you will, shell of a house so that students go out and they actually install the units, they run the ductwork, they do the wiring, they install the thermostats. So very much a real-world working environment simulation that they would encounter when they go to work. Automotive systems technology, keep in mind that this facility is first and foremost located in a space that was designed and built over 30 years ago in the early 80s. I know firsthand that Dick Shirley Chevrolet, Cox Toyota, Darrell Allen, their service centers look nothing like this. All right, so this not only is an old facility, it's not only a cramped facility, but it is not representative of what a modern service center looks like and how it operates. A few things to point to your attention. If you look at the lower left-hand corner of the screen, you notice the yellow caution tape. These are pathways that need to remain clear for safety reasons, obviously, OSHA standards. And our instructors and students are very challenged to keep this done all the time, given the equipment that they have to use when they're conducting class, some of their diagnostic equipment, jacks, and so forth. So although they do the best job that they possibly can to keep those aisles clear, it's often a challenge. The ceiling is coming down in certain areas. They battle literally squirrel nests. So there, you know, this is definitely a facility that is in need of some attention. This illustrates to you how close the lifts are together, and I'm told by the department head, you may have a difficult time seeing it here, but when vehicles are up on the lifts, they actually have to stagger the heights because the lifts are so close together. You can see, I don't think it's much more than a foot or a foot and a half in between those lifts. Something else to point out, in the back of the slide, you notice that each one of the bay doors, which I believe we currently have eight, the new facility would provide for 12 bays. But in order to move vehicles in and out, of course, those doors have to come open. And in the summertime, in the wintertime, when there are extreme temperatures, you know, this is not very comfortable for students, of course. A more modern design, as you'll see in a couple of slides, would remedy this situation. But again, just an indication of how close those lifts are together. Now, I do want to say that this slide actually looks like a junk room, but it is really not. What you're seeing here is just the fact that there is a lot of diagnostic equipment and jacks and other instructional supplies where there are no two of the same thing in here, so there's no uniformity. So it doesn't look like it, but it really is organized. And again, you see the pathway there taped off that has to remain clear. And this is just to illustrate, again, that they need more space in the actual lab because we're not able to effectively utilize the teaching space because we've got it cluttered up with equipment that is needed in order to do class demonstrations and so forth. This is a depiction of a state-of-the-art facility, what more automotive service centers resemble nowadays. Again, I spoke of the bay doors. This design is such as our new Advanced Applied Technology Center would be, that there would be one entrance to bring vehicles in and one entrance for vehicles to exit. The lifts are farther apart, and you can see that there is ample storage against the back wall for the tools, diagnostic equipment and so forth, and that just is, you know, essentially because there is much more space. So that is our automotive systems technology program. Computer integrated machining, you're looking here at our CNC lab. We currently have space for only 4 machines for CNCs. Want to call to your attention that companies have approached us locally about donating equipment in terms of machines. We don't have the space to do that. The current infrastructure will not allow for additional power. We would have to do some serious upgrades in terms of upfitting to provide for additional power outlets to essentially get these machines working. To the left, you notice there's a makeshift computer lab footprint that's literally on the shop floor that's taking up square footage that could occupy another machine. And you see, you know, in the back, just crowded conditions with students crowding around machines and so forth. So again, we're looking at 4 CNC machines in our current facility. In our manual facility, our manual machining facility, which is one classroom down, we have only 6 lathes and 6 vertical presses. We could do more. Again, we have turned down, or we have opted not to apply for various grants that we have been told essentially we would qualify for, simply because if we were awarded the grant money, we don't have space to put the machines when we purchase them. This is Randolph Community College. Their machining facility has been open, I think, roughly 2 years, and I don't have the numbers, but clearly they have a lot more than 4 CNC machines, 6 lathes, 6 vertical presses. I have another slide here illustrating this facility. I've spoken with my counterpart at Randolph Community College, and she tells me that when they vacated their old machining space into this new facility, they were able to expand their welding technologies program, and that both programs have increasing enrollment. Finally, this is our welding technology program. This is in the same building, sharing space with automotive systems technology. So again, it was designed and built over 30 years ago. We currently have 12 welding booths. The new facility would be designed to accommodate 24, so we could double that. There are definite safety concerns with our current welding technology facility. You don't see all 12 of those welding booths on this slide. To the right, there is another row, if you will. So this makes it difficult for the instructor to monitor all of the students in the lab at the same time. Some other points to make is that because welding and automotive, by the way, also run programs. They run from 8 o'clock in the morning till 10:30 at night. They run morning sections, afternoon sections, and evening sections. They are at capacity. The welding department head often has to run what we call stacked sections, and what that means is that there may be two or three different classes occupying the same space at the same time, which again makes it difficult for the instructor to monitor not only just the students in general, but the individual tasks that they're working on. Often in welding, they have to open their bay door and set up makeshift in the front of that building. And in the summertime, in the wintertime, again, this facility is not climate controlled, so uncomfortable conditions for the instructors and the students. This is an example of a problem that we have with storage specifically for our welding department. This is actually the back of the facility that currently houses welding. We have to block traffic off on our north entrance when we accept deliveries of bar stock and steel, basically, for the welding technologies program. They're offloading materials in excess of 6,000 to 8,000 pounds, and what you see here is our department head actually maneuvering some of that steel with a forklift over parked cars, and of course we consider safety, we consider liability, and so forth. So, you know, this does create a problem. This is a more state-of-the-art facility. So again, one of the things that jumps out at me here is that an instructor could stand at either end and monitor the entire lab. Obviously, there's more space, there's clearly ventilation, and additional welding booths and so forth. And again, this is not, you know, what we have. This is our vision for, you know, how we could do so much better. And definitely with our welding and our automotive in particular, you know, these programs are at capacity and are in very cramped spaces, facilities that are just not modern. Again, that don't accurately depict the conditions in which students are going to be working when they graduate and get employment. Okay? And having said that, I'm going to turn it back over to Dr. Gatewood, who will give you some closing remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Mr. Chair, members of the commission, let me close by saying that Alamance Community College has excellent faculty. They know their trades. They know how to get the job done and prepare high-quality students for workers. But what we don't have is adequate facilities. We need adequate facilities in order to truly prepare our students to master the emerging technologies, to compete for 21st century jobs, and to be competitive in a knowledge-based society. We truly do want our students to be ready to go into the workplace and be competent workers for business and industry. And we as a college want to continue to be the educational training workforce development hub of Alamance County. In order for us to do this, we need your help. We need you to help us realize the Advanced Applied Technology Center. Therefore, I will make the ask on behalf of Alamance Community College, and I ask that you fund the construction of Alamance Community College's new Advanced Applied Technology Center. Mr. Chair, thank you so much. Commissioners, thank you for hearing us this morning. We will be happy to field any questions that you may have.
Questions for Dr. Gabriel?
I have a question. What's the total population of ACC?
Depends on how you look at it. Because we look at things in headcount, and then we're looking at things in terms of FTE. FTE, we're just under 5,000. Annual unduplicated headcount ranges between 9 and 15,000. So those are people.
What do you expect the cost to build this facility? Have you considered the cost and what you plan to build?
Absolutely, sir. We have considered the cost, and I'm going to defer that question, if I may, Mr. Chair, to Mr. Kenan Briggs, Chief Financial Officer.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Members of the Council, good morning. I think under consideration is an ask for $15 million, which the voters approved in a bond referendum approximately 2 years ago. For that amount of money, we've asked our architects to sharpen their pencil, given cost escalation in construction and other factors. We will do work with the $15 million, if you make that available to us, to expand the spaces and provide the instructional areas for the students at $15 million. I believe that's what you've recommended and suggested, and that's what we're going to try to manage and live with.
What's the operational cost differential versus your existing sites versus the new site? Have you come up with an analogy or an analysis on that?
Mr. Briggs, would you?
Mr. Chair, is it okay? Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Sutton. We are currently using a template designed by the state to try to estimate those finished spaces and what that will mean to our utility operations. There will be an additional cost. There isn't any question about it, because when you add new space, you're going to add those utility costs. But we're currently trying to calculate that based on the architect's best renderings of what that will be. So I don't have a firm number, but I clearly
see the cost. And I'm not going to be here in 3 months to worry about it, but you know, I think it ought to be discussed as far as the differential between existing now and the future, and as far as county dollars that you're going to be requesting in the 15-16 budget. And my last question, or essentially up front here now, is what are you going to do with the existing spaces that you're in now if this came to fruition?
Very good question, sir. In 2011, at the board retreat, there was a discussion about how we would use the existing facilities. And what we plan to do is repurpose those facilities. We already have horticulture, for example, encroaching on the space of automotive mechanics and welding. So if you can imagine a unit, automotive and welding, two units that don't have enough space, and then here's horticulture already moving in on them, then it just creates a bad situation. So horticulture will be in the mix. Mr. Briggs, would you like to speak further?
Sure. Mr. Chairman. Thank you. It's a great question. I think what we could do, which would have a really important impact on deferring future facility costs, from the earlier slide the President showed you, when we vacate space for automotive, welding, HVAC, it's not only in the automotive building, but it's also in general classroom buildings in older facilities. We would backfill and renovate that space and use it for general classroom and other instructional space, such as industrial systems, technology, and other kinds of things. So by capturing and repurposing that space, it will clearly enable us to defer additional construction costs in the future.
Any other questions, John?
Yes, sir. I assume you'll have additional income once the space is built and ready to use. Will you have other resources other than just county commissioner money to help fund that? The day-to-day expense and the operation of the programs?
So let me begin, and then I'm going to ask Mr. Briggs to participate in responding to your question. But we will generate additional resources, one, because this is the programs that we're talking about today creates an opportunity for us to be reimbursed at a higher level, a higher rate than many of our other programs. So our state funding will increase. Moreover, we'll be able to address the needs of more students. And Mr. Briggs, you want to take it from there, please, sir?
Mr. Chairman, Spacely, thank you for your question. Many years ago, the state defined responsibilities, as I'm confident you understand, between the construction and operations of facility, which are local responsibility, and the operational programs that go on within those facilities. Dr. Gatewood said it exactly right. We will draw additional state resources for both instruction, faculty, and student support, as well as equipment, because everything is FTE driven. But in terms of the operational cost, there's a clear delineation in the statute between that local responsibility to operate and maintain the facilities and the state responsibility to fund programs. So there, I think that gets back to Mr. Sutton's point. While we'll realize additional revenue for instruction and student support and equipment, that operating cost will be borne by the county by statute.
Yes, won't you also have the ability to bring in additional grants?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Absolutely, sir. I think there, as the President and Mr. Queen noted earlier, I think there are huge opportunities for private philanthropic support, for federal and state funded grants, for the operations and improvements of facilities that we can't avail ourselves of now because we don't have the space in which to locate them. So that's a very important point. Thank you.
Didn't Randolph County enact a optional sales tax to pay for their expansions there, if I'm not mistaken? Is that not correct? That's what I thought. I'd like to get Tom Manning, if he will, to give us, you know, I've been concerned about the financing of this and or what obligation we're going to put onto the new board. We've got Dan Engel taking a seat, Eddie, and John and I will be stepping down, and we possibly could lose a third one. So you're putting an obligation on a future board to decide whether or not property tax is going to need to be raised and so forth and so on. So I asked about our bond indebtedness, and it's my understanding that we're going to be losing $1 million about going debt service as a result of
Tim, I've talked with Tom. He's going to give us.
He's going to give that. Yes. Okay, good. Because that was a concern of mine, so it appears to be almost a break-even scenario, at least on bond indebtedness. And so I'm glad to hear Tom's going to give us a report.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. Thank you.
As I just stated, I've talked with our finance officer, and he has done research not only with the LGC, Local Government Commission, but also with our bond attorney that we have used for many, many years in New York City, Gundar Zaparans. And Tom, are you ready?
Yes, sir. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Thank you for that segue, Tim. Susan Roberts and I have actually talked with bond counsel, as well as paid a visit to our friends at the Local Government Commission to help us get an update on what the process would be if we proceed on the discussed item. Also, I'd like to thank Clyde Albright for having discussions with Gundars as well. The process from where we are today, should the board elect to proceed, includes initially a statement and a passage of what's called the resolution of findings. This is what Gundars prepared for us, and it was based on what has changed since the facility issue was approved by the voters 2 years ago. And you may recall at that time, we did not, as a board, wish to increase property taxes and raise property taxes to fund that expenditure, but rather ask the voters to approve a sales tax to fund that along with some economic development opportunities. Well, the need for the facility was passed by the voters, but the need to pay for it was not. So therefore, we were in limbo, but we had the opportunity and the time to revisit this under the terms of the initial passage of the issuance of bonds. So that brings us to where we are today, and in our meeting with the Local Government Commission, they propose a calendar for how we could move on once we have the resolution of findings passed by this board. I'll get to your question, Tim, about the debt payments, but if we proceed today with the approval of the facility and moving forward, then we would ask the Board of Trustees at the Community College to immediately go out and rebid the products. You all were asking about total costs and how it's different from 2 years ago. They would actually go out and rebid the project cost, hopefully soon, like this week, and get bids back by the first part of November. If that was in line and the bids were acceptable, then contract would be approved by the ACC board, subject to the issuance of the bonds and the sale of the bonds. If that happens, the bonds may be issued and sold as early as late winter of 2015, so 4 months from now. That would be good for a number of reasons in terms of the timing of this. Mainly because they're not as busy right now at the Local Government Commission, and interest rates remain fairly low. They're expected to rise sometime mid to late 2015. We think we could get in at a really good program at this time. Annual debt service on $15 million, Tim, if you count the interest, is somewhere between $1.1 million and $1.2 million per year. And that's it varies because the timing of the issuance of the bonds may not all be issued in one increment, and then the repayment of the bonds, unlike our personal mortgages, the repayment of the bonds is a fixed amount of principal twice a year and then plus interest. So it actually declines over the life of the bond. But as you suggested, we currently have in our debt schedule right now a reduction projected in debt payments used for our existing bond and note indebtedness. From 2015, end of fiscal year 2015, the year that we're in now, to the end of fiscal year 2016, the amount of debt service is going to decline about $1 million. The following year, it declines an additional $800,000, and the following year, an additional $700,000. So cumulatively, it's certainly more than the debt service created by the issuance of this $15 million in bonds. So from a capital standpoint, that is, if we look at capital projects that we fund, just like we did the courthouse plans and the other renovations we've had in recent years, we can say comfortably that the issuance of these bonds would not translate into a tax increase, because after the bonds are issued, it would be another probably 6 months or so before the first payment. We're into that next fiscal year. Our total debt payments are coming down by $1 million. So yes, we're swapping debt for debt. We would not see an incremental tax increase by the issuance of $15 million of bonds. Now, that's not to say in our overall budget next year, we're going to have other needs, we're going to have other revenue sources, other expenses. That's a whole nother discussion. But if we strictly look at the capital part and we swap debt for debt, the $1.1 to $1.2 million in debt service would be absorbed by the reduction on what we already have out there. And as we've talked about in here before, the county's debt position right now is in a particularly attractive state. We certainly have the capacity to leverage ourselves a little bit for the right reasons. I do want to just make a couple of comments. I talked about interest rates being low. We have actually projected conservatively in our bond schedule an interest rate of 5%. We think we can do better than that, but again, the 5% is how we came up with the total amount of the $15 million plus roughly $800,000 in total interest. It would be less, obviously, if interest rates were lower. Want to just comment briefly on the economic changes here in Alamance County since the 2012 vote, because remember at that time we as a board said this is not the time to put a property tax increase burden on our citizens, and that's why when we approved this thing, it was like, okay, we'll do it, but with the sales tax. Here's what's changed since 2012. Our overall sales tax revenue has increased $1.5 million from fiscal year 2012 to 2014. Again, other revenue source. The unemployment rate has dropped from 10% as of July 30th of 2012 to, just in the paper over the weekend, 6.9% July 31st of 2014. Since 2012, we've had major corporate announcements for new business and expansion, including Walmart, Sheetz, Camro, GKN expansion, Kaiser Roth expansion, all during the past 2 years. All these projects together, we are projecting over 800 new jobs and over $150 million in new investment. That $150 million in new investment is added to the property tax base, and that's critical, but that's the growth that we, I think, all desire. Our Alamance County available fund balance, as we've discussed, from 2 years ago has increased from $14 million to projected $25 million. And our fund balance percentage has improved from 11.3% at June 30th, 2012 to nearly 20%. It's 19.7% projected for this year. Peer average for our group of counties is around 25%. Dr. Gatewood has already outlined the needs, the programs that will be utilized in this new building. The other thing we have received just coincidentally during this process is the Standard & Poor's has reaffirmed our bond rating. It is AA-, which for a county our size, that's about the best we can hope to be. So the local government commission knows this. They are in agreement that the county's financial condition is sound and the time to proceed with this is appropriate. Obviously, they want to see, and we want to see, our fiscal year-end June 30th statement, but that's coming along shortly. Any questions?
What was the growth in our revenues from 12-13 to 13-14? Would that be right? 13-14?
The total revenues from, mm-hmm. from all sources?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, gosh, Tim.
Percentage, if you got it.
I'll turn to... I don't have that number.
Don't we normally grow at 3% a year, 4% a year?
Around about that amount.
Yeah, and the property tax revenue was
right.
that. We did not change the tax rate last year, so yeah, that would have been the fundamental core growth. However, we had better growth in our sales tax revenue, mm-hmm. and we also had now better growth in our registered motor vehicle tax. Mm-hmm. And that's been a project that actually something that the state did that has worked out.
Are we on track for 3-4 this fiscal year?
Yes.
Okay. You can't claim any tax increase next year, all right?
Any other questions?
Let y'all worry about that.
Sorry, Tom. Any other questions for Tom? Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, sir.
Let me read to the board the resolution that the county attorney and our bond attorney have recommended, told us that is required for passage, and I'd like to read it into the record. Resolution relating to the authorization of community college bonds of the County of Alamance, North Carolina. Whereas the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina is considering providing for the issuance of not exceeding $15 million community college bonds of the county pursuant to an order adopted said board on August 20, 2012, which order was approved by the vote of a majority of the qualified voters of the county who voted thereon at a referendum duly called and held on November 6, 2012, for the purpose of providing funds with any other available funds for expanding and improving the facilities for Alamance Community College, including the construction of an additional building and other facilities to provide additional space for classrooms, laboratories, and storage, and the acquisition of any necessary land, equipment, and furnishings, collectively called the project. Whereas it is necessary to take certain related action at this time, now therefore be it determined and resolved by the Board of Commissioners for the county as follows. Section 1, said board hereby finds and determines in connection with authorizing the issuance of the bonds that one, in accordance with information provided to it by the trustees of Alamance Community College, the issuance of the bonds is necessary or expedient for the county to provide funds for much needed additional and improved community college facilities in the county. 2, the principal amount of the bonds is adequate and not excessive for the proposed purpose of the bonds because it is based upon said trustees' best estimates of the cost of the project and related uses of funds and said trustees' best estimates of the sources of funds that will be available for such purpose. 3, the county's debt management procedures and policies are good and will be managed in strict compliance with law. 4, the increase in taxes, if any, necessary to service the bonds will not be excessive because it is expected that any increase in taxes for such purpose will not exceed 1 cent per $100 of the appraised value of property subject to taxation by the county. And 5, the bonds can be marketed at reasonable rates of interest. Section 2, any and all prior findings, determinations, resolutions, or other actions of said board that are inconsistent with this resolution are hereby superseded to the extent that they are inconsistent with this resolution. This resolution will take effect immediately upon passage. At this time, I move that the board approve this resolution for building the building as described. I hear
a
second.
I'll second.
Any further discussion?
All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passes unanimously. Thank you very much, and old people like me need to stretch every now and then. We're going to take about a 5-minute recess.